all know how I start my messages. I start with something on the lighter side. A third grade religion class was reviewing the Ten Commandments. The teacher asked one youngster, if mother told Johnny not to tease the dog and pull his tail, and he did that anyway, what commandment would he be breaking? The child responded, I don't know the number of the commandment, but it says, what God has joined, let no man separate. My prayer today is, let no man deceive himself. If any man over here thinks of himself to be wise, let him become a fool, for the foolishness of this world, for the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, from 1 Corinthians 3. That is the prayer I have for myself, that it is not my wisdom, it is the wisdom of God that flows through me, so that his word will come forth and it will accomplish its course. I'm a nobody, and as I stand over here, that is my prayer. So let's look to the Lord in prayer. A loving most heavenly Father, we come to your presence. We thank you, Lord, for this time. Lord Jesus, this time is about you. This place is about you. We as your people are all about you. Father, I pray that you will hide me behind your cross. Remove any wickedness in me, anything that will stop your word from flowing to me and through me to your people. We pray, Lord, that we will be edified and that we will give you all the glory as we explore from the scripture the beauty that is in Jesus Christ and the strategies and the plans that you have for each one of us. We pray, Lord, that you will make it very clear and evident in our lives so that as we seek you, you will be found and that you will be with us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, because we give you all the glory for the cross. We thank you that you came and that we are your children. We are bought with the price of your blood on the tree. We ask you, Lord Jesus, that you will increase and that we will decrease. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before I start, I want to thank God for this opportunity. About 4 or 5 days ago, I was out of the city. I was in Seattle on a client-side engagement when I got an email from Josh asking if I could actually bring the Lord's word today. I actually didn't respond to him on that very day because usually I try and jump on the opportunity that God gives me, but for some reason I didn't feel like I wanted to respond immediately. I said, Lord, I need to take this into prayer. And that night I just prayed and I left it out to saying, Lord, should I bring your word on this coming Saturday? I'm not feeling prepared. I have a lot of other things in my mind, a lot of the other world kind of stuff that needs to be done from my business, from my work. But for some reason, the next morning, the first thing I did was, I think, like 5 or 6 in the morning, I wrote a note back to Josh saying, I'll bring the Lord's word, because to me it was an opportunity that if tonight, you know, God takes me home, then I have another opportunity to have brought his word to his people. So I thank God for this opportunity. I stand here as a fallen soldier on the rebound only because of the grace of God and not on my own merit, nothing on my own wisdom. I stand here purely because of the grace of God, and I thank God for the opportunity. Having said that, I also want to counsel unto each one of you to be like the Jews in Berea from Acts chapter 17, verse 11. We see that they were commendable because they went back and they searched the scriptures daily to see if what the disciples were saying was true or not. So whatever is being preached from the pulpit, wherever you hear God's word, I pray that you go back and be like those Jews that were commendable, who were from the city of Berea, who actually went back and searched the scriptures daily to see if what was being preached was true or not. Now imagine for a moment that there was a news channel, and the news channel reported only scriptural or spiritual news. I'm not talking about like a channel like God TV or Daystar or something called TBN. I'm talking about a news channel like CNN or Fox News. And all it reported was news about spiritual things, about scriptural things. What would the news channel be relaying? What is it that matters in the heavenly realms? What is it that matters in the spiritual dimension? I believe there'll be twofold, that news channel will be broken into twofold aspects of the news that will be brought to us. One would be about a searching God, a God who would go after every lost sheep, even if it is one person that is wandering away, there'll be a searching God that'll be going after. The other would be about spiritual warfare. If it was about spiritual things, then it'll be about things that are beyond what we see with our human eye, which we would be hearing about from this news channel. So I just kind of was trying to compile this to see what would that news look like. So some of the news that you would see, the news anchors that would be reporting would be people in Jerusalem reported to have seen a formation in the sky that looked like a hand holding a shepherd's staff that was guiding the people lost in the wilderness back into the temple, where there was great rejoicing and celebration as the lost people returned to the ways ordained by Christ Jesus, the King over all kings. Another news would be the armies of God met for war against the armies of Satan. Michael the archangel led the armies of God, carrying in his hand a cross on which Jesus Christ was nailed. Against the armies of Satan that was led by Legion, Legion and his troops had to retreat to the abyss from where they launched their attack. On the east sector, there were a group of 12 men who pledged their allegiance to Jesus Christ, the captain of the armies of the Lord, who fought alongside the armies of heaven. They were on a mission of delivering hostages that were held captive in a dark room. The rescue attempt led to the capture and killing of 7 out of the 12 men by the enemy, but all hostages were rescued. There was great rejoicing in the courts above the sky for the rescue of the hostages. In the Western Front, the enemy seemed to have an upper hand. Majority of the provinces in the Western region were under what seemed like a spell, under some other powerful force that held them captive. They were swearing their allegiance to the enemy and choosing to defy the armies of God and fight against all those clothed in white. The battle continues in the Indian Peninsula, and so on and so on. Now, for a moment, what may seem as it is very far-fetched and very virtual is as real as it can be in the world we live in today. What we think is virtual is indeed reality. We are at war. We are at war in the heavenly realms, and we are engaged in spiritual warfare. Our church theme for this year is Be Equipped for Warfare, which is taken from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 18. It couldn't be any more appropriate for the times that we're living in. When we look at the world today, we need to be equipped for warfare, not just in the physical dimension, but in the spiritual dimension as well. And to be equipped for warfare in the heavenly realms is the way we do it is by what we do to adorn ourselves with the spiritual armor, with the armor of God. Now, if you take any military strategist, one of the things that they would do before they engage in battle is they will learn about the ways of the enemy. They would go about studying every move that the enemy makes. They will see what the weakest links of the enemy is. They will look into studying what their strengths are. One of the things that Ruben and I do, both of us who are in the Shaolin Kung Fu program, after every sparring tournament, we actually look at the video of that tournament, irrespective of the outcome, whether we won that tournament or we lost it. We'll look at that video and we'll process that video to see what actually happened as we sparred. What were the times when we had the advantage of attacking the opponent and taking a point? Or what were the times when we actually left our guard down and we were defenseless and they took advantage of that situation? So both the attacks and the defenses, we would watch and we would learn from those videos so that the next time we may be a better fighter. The same thing is true when it comes to spiritual warfare. The Bible is the manual for spiritual warfare. That's why I go back to say, be like the Bereans, go back and study the word. It's not just important for us to hear the word, it's not just important for us to read the word, it is equally important for us to go study it, to meditate on it, to memorize it and keep it hidden in our hearts so that we will be in right standing before God, so that we may not sin against him, as what the word declares. So go back and read the Bible, read and validate what is being preached, because this Bible is the one that gives us a great and a beautiful strategy to be able to take the defenses of the enemy. That is what spiritual warfare is. We can't win the battle if we don't go through every single word that is in here that reflects the glory of God in the person of Jesus Christ. And so we have the manual that is given to us. Let us take that so that we can understand what the strategy is. So what is this message that God has laid on my heart for you? It's actually a story of gigantic applications that I'm going to talk to you about. A story that is very, very well known in the Christian circles. It's a story about a young boy, right, who was fair, who was ruddy, who was a young man, I would say, in his youth, who went and fought a giant. So trivia time. What am I referring to? The story of David and Goliath. Goliath was from Dash, who led the armies of the Dash. He was from a place called Gath, who led the armies of the Philistines. How tall was Goliath? He was 6 cubits, which is 1.5 times, a cubit is 1.5 feet, so 9 feet, and he was 6 cubits in the span, so he's about 9 feet and 9 inches. Okay, doesn't really matter. He was a tall guy, all right? So he was a big giant, 9 feet in height. How tall was David? It doesn't say, but we could kind of go back and say that he probably averaged about the same height as Saul, because he was adorned the armor of Saul, and Saul stood ahead about the others. So he was a pretty tall guy, but he was not as tall as Goliath. We don't know. Doesn't matter. What did Saul arm David with before he went to fight the battle? What did Saul ask him to take and put on? Saul actually gave his own armor, which were 3 pieces that is being talked about. One was the helmet of brass, okay, helmet made of brass, a coat of chain mail, and a sword. What was the armor that Goliath was wearing? Interestingly, the armor that Goliath was wearing was the exact same armor that Saul would have worn if he had gone into battle. It is said in 1 Samuel 17:38 is about what Saul's armor was made of, and 1 Samuel 17:5 talks about the armor that Goliath was wearing, which was a helmet that would have been made of brass. He was wearing a coat that was made of chainmail, and he was going to have a sword that he was going to hold. And there was a spear as well that Goliath had. So David, when he went to fight Goliath, did he actually wear Saul's armor? David said that he was, you know, it was not proven, and so he ended up actually giving that armor up. And it would be, so would this be a true statement? David first faced Goliath, who was armored, and prevailed against the giant without wearing an armor. In the physical sense, huh? So in the physical sense, he was not wearing an armor, but David engaged in battle with a different kind of armor. He wore a spiritual kind of armor, and we will see what that armor is, what David was wearing. So let's go back and recap as to what the spiritual armor is, as to what the armor of God is. So what is the armor of God? The belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes that is fitted with the gospel, for that which comes from the gospel of peace, the feet that is ready, or we would say the shoes of the gospel, the shield of faith, and then the helmet of salvation, the sword of the spirit, and finally in prayer, right? We often leave out that last part, but in finally in prayer, with supplication for your saints, you adorn this armor. So there's 7 pieces to that armor. Let's go back and see how David actually wore these 7 pieces. So let's go back to seeing when David goes to face Goliath. Goliath comes to him with a sword, with a spear, and with a shield. Everything that would be able to let this big man fight offensively and defensively. But when David actually faces Goliath, David tells Goliath something. He says, you come to me with sword, with spear, and shield, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 says that the name of the one who is coming, talking about Jesus Christ, is faithful and true. So David wore the belt of truth because the name of the Lord is true. The one who is coming is faithful and true. What does it mean if God, if we say that God is faithful, what does that mean? Like Jonah, if we run away from God, he is faithful to be able to come after that one lost sheep. It doesn't matter how far you run, he will come after you. He will seek you. He will search for you. I ran many times from God. Every time at the end of that road, I found the hand of God waiting so that he could bring me back into his fold. So we see that he is faithful. Like David, if we get ourselves engaged in an adulterous relationship with sex, talking about the lust of the eye, with silver or money, talking about the lust of the flesh, the things that gratify our flesh, the desires of our heart, or with self, talking about the pride of life, it doesn't matter. When we repent, he is a faithful God. He is faithful and just to forgive us of all our unrighteousness and to bring us back into the fold. So he is faithful. His name is faithful. But the good news is, he's not only faithful, he is also true. He's true to his word. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14:6. But he also went on to say, John 8:32, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. It is the knowing of the truth that makes us free. David knew that Jesus Christ, so David knew that the law was true. He went battling, wearing the belt of truth, because he knew that this God was faithful and true, and that freed him from the fear of the giant or the outcome of the battle. So David engaged in the name of the Lord, he engaged in truth. The second piece of armor that David wore was the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate is the piece of armor that guards the chest, which protects the heart. Proverbs 4:23 says, out of the heart comes the wellspring or the issues of life. So we need to guard our heart, and we need to guard our heart at all times. Acts chapter 13, verse 22, talks about David. How did David guard his heart? He was a man that was chosen by God to be the leader of God's people, because David was a man after God's own heart. To guard our heart is to put in our heart the desires and the things that matter most to God, to be after God's own heart. Psalm 27, David makes a wonderful prayer. One of the prayers that I think every one of us should be praying daily, the moment we wake up, this should be the prayer that should be in the top of our lips. Lord, the one thing that I seek, the one thing that I desire most, the only one thing that I want in my life is to be in your house and to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord all the days of my life. That should be our prayer. He desired, he longed to be always gazing on the beauty of God. He guarded his heart. Now I want to tell you a story of another man. Now David was a man who was after God's own heart. I want to tell you the story of another man who the Bible says had a perfect heart. He was a king. He was a king of the land of Judah. This man was born to a king, to another king, whose name was Abijam. Abijam was an evil king. But because of God's promise to David, God actually gave Abijam a son whose name was Asa. And Asa was a godly king. When Asa took the kingship, he first and foremost, he got a message from God through a prophet, a guy named Azariah, who came to Asa and said, if you will seek me and you will follow me, I will be with you. But if you forsake me, I will forsake you. This was God's word that came very direct to Asa. And Asa, as this king, a new king of the land of Judah, he did what was right. The first thing he did, he removed all the idols that were erected by his father, Abijam. Then we find out that Asa went so far that when his own mother, Maachah, erected an idol in a garden, he removed her from office, from being queen of the land. So even his own mother, he said she could not have anything to do with leadership if it would contradict the leadership that God has instituted, which is that they should have worship only one God. And so even his mother, does this. And then he goes and smashes that idol and burns it around this brook called Kidron. Then he actually goes back and tells the people of Judah that you shall all follow the Lord. He, in his kingdom, his people were all worshiping and following the Lord. For 35 years, there was peace in the land. Before that land, the peace came about, there was an Ethiopian, a guy named Zerah. And Zerah came against this king of Judah, Asa, with 1 million men and 300 chariots. Now Asa resorted to the one thing he knew he had to do. He went in prayer before God. He cried to the Lord and he said, "Nothing is impossible with you, whether it is large or small. It doesn't matter because you are God. We rest on you." Those were the words he used. The King James Version says, "We rest on you, and in your name we will go out to fight." In another meaning, he was saying, "We rely totally on you, Lord." God was faithful. He gave Asa victory over the 1 million men and 300 chariots that Zerah brought over against Asa. And Asa, it was said, which is recorded in 2 Chronicles 14, 15, 16, and 1 Kings 15, that he had a perfect heart. 35 years of his reign was a perfect, peaceful reign. On the 36th year, the king of Israel, another king called Baasha, came against Asa, the king of Judah. I don't know the reasons why, but Asa, instead of resorting back to what he did when he fought the Ethiopian the first time, he instead goes to Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, and gives him a bribe to come and help him. So God, seeing this, sends a prophet named Hanani. Hanani comes over to Asa and tells Asa, "What you're doing is foolish, because the eyes of the Lord is searching. It's going to and fro the entire world to see if there is one who is perfect unto God. You were that person. Don't go after relying on a king of Syria who can help you." Asa compounds his foolishness, imprisons Hanani, oppresses the others who come and bring him the news. And so he continues on in his foolishness. 3 years later, Asa is struck with the disease of the foot. I believe symbolically, God was saying to Asa, "You cannot stand on your own. You cannot stand on the confidence of other men, be it the king of Syria or anybody else. You have to rely on me for victory." 1 year later, Asa dies. A man who had a perfect heart, he went imperfect in his ways. We need to guard our heart at all times. David, when he faced the warrior, the one who had a perfect, a man who was after God's own heart, when he faced the warrior, he took and guarded his heart, he put on the breastplate of righteousness. But when David faced a woman, Bathsheba, he did not guard his heart. He left that breastplate of righteousness alongside. And he fell and he committed murder and adultery, the things that displeased the Lord. But the good news is, righteousness, what does that mean? Righteousness means right standing, to be blameless, to stand upright before God. We were created to be upright before God. But in our sinfulness, we can't stand on our own merit. We can't stand on our own legs when we stand before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. When we stand before God the Judge, if you and I have not been imputed by the blood of Jesus Christ, he will be looking at you, and he'll be looking at you like he looked at Asa. But if we have that clothing of the righteousness of God, because we believed in Jesus Christ, his righteousness is imputed on us. And when God the Father looks at Mano Paul the sinner, he no longer sees a sinner, but he sees Jesus Christ his son who took Mano Paul's place. He looks at you and me, and if we have believed in Christ, we can stand right before God if we believed in the name of Jesus Christ. So David over there, in the name of the Lord, he stands, relying not on his own strength, adorning on himself the breastplate of righteousness, guarding his heart for the things that mattered only to God. He guarded it at all times as he faced Goliath. And then when we go on to look at the next part of the armor, the feet that is fitted with readiness for that which comes from the gospel of peace, the shoes of the gospel. You know what David does when he gets to the army camp? the first thing that he does is he leaves his carriage behind and he runs to his brothers. The Bible is very explicit. It says that David ran to his brothers. And then he recognizes, he sees that Israel has lost its peace. 1 Samuel 17, 11 and 24 says that the people in Israel were extremely afraid when they heard and when they saw this giant that was posing murderous threats on them. He was defying the armies of God. He was defying God himself. He in fact cursed, he threw curses on the God of Israel when he meets with David. And these people were afraid. They had no peace. They were robbed of their peace. And you see David running first to meet his brothers. And then you know what? It's beautiful because the scripture says that when David went to meet Goliath, he ran towards the camps of the Philistines. He ran. He was ready to go to fight because he knew that his feet had to be fitted with the readiness to restore the peace of Israel. The armor that he was wearing at this point was the shoes of the gospel to go back and say that I will not let anything that robs the peace of God's people. I am going to run. I'm going to be ready to go and do this. How does that apply to us? Philippians chapter 4 verse 7 says, the peace that passeth all understanding or transcends all understanding is found in none other but in Jesus Christ. Are you and I ready to run to share that good news, that gospel, so that that peace could be there? Because the God of this world, 2 Corinthians 4, 4 says, the God of this world has robbed people of that peace because he's blinded the minds of many lest they see the glorious truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So the application to us is we should be ready to take that gospel to the people. Isaiah chapter 52 verse 7 says, oh, how beautiful are the feet of those who come in the mountain who bring the good news that publishes peace. That should be what our motto should be. Will our feet be fitted with readiness for that which comes from the gospel of peace? Just like David ran towards restoring the peace of Israel. He fitted himself with the feet, with the shoes of the gospel of peace. And then we move on to the next part of the armor, which is the shield of faith. Did Goliath carry a shield? Was that? He did not carry a shield. He had a shield bearer. There was a shield bearer who went in front of him. Imagine this big guy, right? Who even needed someone to carry his own shield, completely fortified. David did not go with a shield to fight with Goliath. But David carried with him a shield of faith, which was far greater than the shield or the protection that Goliath's shield would have been able to bring about. So how is this shield of faith? What is the shield of faith that David carried? So what is faith? Hebrews 11:1 defines faith for us that it is the evidence of things unseen, right? And it's the substance of the things that we don't see, of the invisible. That is faith. Things that we see which are unseen is faith. I remember the story someone talked about when in a place, in a land where it was stricken with drought, the pastor actually announced that next Sunday we're going to have a prayer for rain. So the congregation got together the next Sunday for a prayer for rain, and there was an old lady who walked into the building at the very end. As she was walking, as they were starting the prayer, she was the one who walked in with an umbrella. That is faith. They came to pray for faith. She had seen that the heavens would be open for it to rain. And so faith is things that we see which is unseen. Now, I said earlier that Israel was sorely afraid. They were greatly afraid. They were dismayed because of this giant. Right? So they were very fearful. What is the opposite of fear? Is it courage? Is it bravery? According to the Bible, the opposite of fear is faith. When Jesus calmed the storm, he calmed it, and then he posed two questions to his disciples. The first question that Jesus asked was, why are you afraid? And the second question is, why don't you have any faith? He didn't say, why don't you have any courage? In order for us to combat the fearful things that come against our life, we need to be able to erect the shield of faith. As Goliath was hurling down threats to David, he was upholding the shield of faith because he was seeing the invisible. Now, how is it that David saw the invisible? We can get that from what he actually tells and states confidently to Goliath. He says, this day, God will hand you over to me. Into my hand, you will be given, because he saw the hand of God fighting the battle, because he says the battle belonged to the Lord. David was fully confident. There's another incident where in the city of Dothan, the king of Syria comes against Israel. This is recorded in 2 Kings 6. And as he comes after Israel and he comes after God's prophet Elisha, Elisha is in there, and the king of Syria sends multitude of chariots and a multitude of his army to come and capture this prophet of God and to take over Israel. And Elisha is over there when his servant runs up to Elisha and tells Elisha, what are we going to do? We've been completely surrounded. Elisha makes a very interesting statement. He tells the servant, the ones who are with us outnumber the ones who are around us. And then Elisha prays, O Lord, open the eyes of my servant. And the Lord miraculously opens the eyes of his servant. And you know what the servant sees? He sees the entire army and the mountain is surrounded by chariots of fire. The servant, through the eyes of faith, saw supernatural armies ready to engage in battle. David, when he wore the goggles of faith, he saw that the hand of God was there, already delivering Goliath to him. And he makes that statement, you will be mine today, because the Lord will deliver you, not by his own strength, not by his own power, but by the Spirit of God. David will win that. And so he held on to the shield of faith. And then we move on to how David wore the helmet of salvation. Salvation is about deliverance. The helmet is about something that protects the mind. And as you see David getting ready for this encounter with Goliath, there are a few other things that happen before actually David sets foot in this battle camp. As soon as he goes and meets his brother Eliab, interestingly, the three brothers of David, one was named Eliab, which means God is my father, all right? The other was Abinadab, which is God, the one who keeps his vows, his vows or his offerings, and the one who is of a noble kind. And Shammah, which means the Lord is there, all three of them were hiding in the camps. These whose names essentially meant that God was there. He was their father. He was there for them. He was the one who will keep his promises. They were hiding. And Eliab, the eldest brother of David, scolds David and tells him that you have come here with an intention that is not right. You've come to watch the war. So David first gets put down by his brother Eliab. Then when he goes and meets with Saul, Saul looks at David and he goes, you're a young man. This man you're going to fight has been a warrior since his youth. Not something that a king should be telling the only one person who's wanting to go fight for him, right? But Saul was looking at the warrior giant and not looking at the warrior God that was going to be with David. And so he's telling him these things, which to any ordinary mind, if I was in that situation, most likely I would start to either become nervous or I would start to think about, do I even stand a chance? The king of Israel is telling me that I'm just a nobody, whereas this other person is a fully man, a veteran, a seasoned veteran in the art of war. And I'm going to go fight this guy. My brother is scolding me, saying that I have come here with an unclean intention. things that would discourage, words that would actually come and hurt you, are what are being spoken by many around us. And in order to guard the mind, David goes back. No, I'm not going to. He actually says, when Eliab scolds him, the Bible says, he turned to another, basically saying he just shrugged off what the response was to say, I'm not going to let this influence my mind. I'm going to hold on, knowing that in Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3, it says, he will keep in perfect peace whose mind is fixed or stayed on him, on God. So if I have my mind fixed on God, there is absolutely nothing that can penetrate me. So he had that, knowing very well that salvation was of the Lord, that deliverance today was of the Lord. And so he wore that helmet of salvation before he engaged in battle with Goliath. And then we see that he also took the sword of the Spirit. Now, how did David take the sword of the Spirit? In fact, interesting, the Bible in 1 Samuel chapter 17 explicitly says, and David had no sword in his hand. And it says that Goliath carried a sword. So David had no sword in his hand. But you know what happened before David actually took that stone and he slung it and fell Goliath? The battle had already begun. A battle of words was taking place. And the sword of the Spirit is the word of God. When Jesus fenced the devil and he overcame the devil in his temptation, Jesus used each time the sword of the Spirit by saying, it is written, it is written, it is written. Jesus wielded that sword like there was no other. And the same thing David does when he gets to fight with Goliath. What Goliath actually tells David as he gets to approach as David approaches Goliath is, you come to me with staves or like sticks and stones. Am I a dog? Right? So Goliath saw the staff that David was holding on, a stave or a staff, and the sticks and stone as what a shepherd would. And David's response was, it is written, God's rod shall be my, the rod and staff shall be my comfort. And as David, Goliath goes on to throw even further threats, I will kill you today and I will feed you to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. It is written, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for the Lord is with me. David was fighting his battle with spiritual weaponry even before he took that physical stone and he flung it at Goliath. So he was wearing the sword of the Spirit, and he was having it, and he was carrying it. He used it. As Goliath would throw insults on him, as Goliath would throw threats on him, his responses were all according to the scriptures. The same manner in which we should be fighting our spiritual warfare. And then in prayer, though it's not explicitly stated that David actually prayed before he went and fought with Goliath, Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20 says that the Lord is able to do unto us exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can even say or think. Our thoughts are a prayer unto God. So as we even think about the needs that we have, God is listening. The thoughts that David had was fixed on God. He was one who was after God's own heart. He knew that the victory over there was not the victory that Israel was going to win that day, but it was a victory that God was going to win. Because you know the reason why David engaged in battle? The reason that David engaged in battle is very explicitly stated in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 46. And they will know that there is a God in Israel. His thoughts were to prove that there is no other God but one God. And that God is the God who will stand by and fight no matter how big the giant is that is coming against you. David's prayer was for God to show up. And God did show up. When he went to fight against Goliath, he fought with the entire armor completely adorned on him. And he knew that the victory would be won. See, prayer, it's a very powerful thing. Someone said, When the weakest of the saints is on their knees, the devil trembles. When the weakest of the saints is on their knees, the devil trembles. The power that we have in prayer, because you are in communion with God, you see what He wants you to see, you are in tune with Him, completely, always, He's thinking about you and you are thinking about Him. I was flying here yesterday, just before I boarded the flight in Denver Airport, Ruben was on the phone with me, and Ruben said, so I was getting into the airplane, and I said, I need to turn the phone off. And he said, after a few minutes, he called back and he said, you didn't say bye to me, right? So, and then I said, bye, Ruben, I need to turn the phone off because I'm getting into the flight. Then as I got into the plane, after a few minutes, he called me back again before I put my phone into the airplane mode. And he said, Dad, I've got a question for you. And I said, what is your question? And he said, you know what? After some time, once you're up in the air, they'll tell you can turn your electronics back on. Can you call me at that time? Right? And I said, I will explain to you when I come home as to why I won't be able to do that, but I'll be thinking about you, and good night, go to sleep. You know, I love you, and we'll have the phone done. That is the kind of desire we should have of our communion with God. That is the kind of desire He has for us. Can you call me? Can you call me? The things of the world will prevent you from getting access to me. But the moment you get access, can you call me, is what God is asking us. The way we make that connection is through prayer. Imagine, like, for a moment, Carmen actually very beautifully, he pictures what happens in the caverns of hell when somebody prays. So the story that he goes to paint, and he says it this way, and he says it this, in the caverns, in the center of the caverns of hell, where the morbid domain of the power of the prince of this air dwells. A scaled creature suddenly disrupts Satan's ghastly existence with a message. And that message reads, code red problem, disaster forecasted, conference needed immediately. With a disgusted annoyance, the general of evil agrees to confer with his chief demon lieutenant. This is the account, the story of that encounter. There's a knock on the door. You may enter. Sir, state your business and make it fast. We're having problems of cataclysmic proportions. What's going on? Sir, there is problems. Is there a problem with my abortion clinics? No, sir. We're killing 4,000 humans a day unborn in the name of selective breeding for the sake of convenience. It's like the Nazis and the Jews, except that it's now with government approval. Is there a problem with my pet project, television violence? No, sir, we have that covered, from video games to videos to cartoons. By the time a child graduates high school, he or she has seen about 70,000 murders. So is there a problem with my false religion? No, sir, business is booming. There are 40 million who believe New Age and Zen, 45 million believe in astrology. Only 50 million claim to be born again. So is there a problem with business in general? No, sir. Teenage runaways, 1 million or more in a year. A teen commits suicide every 90 minutes. Business is booming. There is nothing. In fact, your specialty, the drunk driving, is going to cost more lives this year than the whole Vietnam War. So then what is the problem? You know, sir. What is the problem? You know, sir. What is the problem? It cannot be. Don't tell me it is so. You know, sir. Oh, don't tell me those saints, those sanctified, blood-bought, redeemed saints of God, are now on their knees in prayer. Yes, sir. They're literal holy terrors. they cast us, they bind us. And sir, if you don't intervene very soon, we will all end up in a bunch of pigs. But sir, that is the good news. What? Sir, the subject of their prayer threatens our very survival. It's causing hemorrhaging in the realms of darkness. What is it? Sir, they are praying to be unified as one under the leadership of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're praying for revival. Oh, then I am going to go after them as a flood. Sir, it is written that the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against them, against you. Then I will make weapons. Sir, it is written, no weapons that is formed against them shall prosper. I know. Then I'm going to hit them with every filthy and lusty thought that they could ever imagine. Sir, it is written that God will keep them in perfect peace whose mind is fixed on God. Well, we've underestimated the enemy. It is time for me to unleash my most vicious and final onslaught on the people of God. And what would that be, sir? I am going to remind the saints of who they were, that they were murderers, they were adulterers, they were liars, they were cheaters, they were killers. Sir, you know what will happen if you remind the saints of the past. And what is that? Sir, they will remind you of your future. Spiritual battle is when we engage to be in the army of God. We don't fight the war. God fights the war for us. We have to be clothed for battle. Imagine if you show up to an army camp and you're wearing the wrong uniform, or you don't have the uniform. Our warfare is against principalities, against darkness, in the heavenly realms, against powers. But we fight that war to stay in the battle, not out of the battle. Christians, as followers of Christ, the beautiful thing is that the victory is won. The outcome is already known. In fact, if you go to Revelation chapter 16, verse 17, Revelation chapter 16, verse 16 talks about Armageddon, and the armies of God got together in this mountain called Megiddo or Armageddon, and they were going to war against the armies of the evil one. And I wish that there was more about what they describe in that battle. But no. Revelation 16, 16 tells about the armies getting together in Armageddon. Revelation 16, 17 says, it is finished. It is done. There was a voice that was heard. He builds up this whole climax, and then he just goes, it is done. The same words that were said by Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. It is finished. So what is the application of what we've learned today? If you have not accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, if you've not believed in His name and you've not confessed your sins, so that because He's faithful and just to cleanse us of all unrighteousness and impute His righteousness on you, if you've not done that, you don't even have an entry into God's army. We can't even talk about putting on the armor of God because you don't even belong to that army. So take time, take stock to yourself and think, have I not done that? Because 2 Corinthians 6:2 says, today is your day of salvation. In other words, it's saying, today is the day that you can engage in battle. Today is the day you could become part of God's army. And if you are one who is a soldier in God's army, as I suspect many of us are, who accepted the Lord, who believed in God, in Christ Jesus, that there is no other means to salvation but by Jesus Christ because of the blood that He shed as remission for our sins. If you have and you're part of it, then this is the way we put on that armor as David did. We wear the belt of truth, by engaging in spiritual warfare in the name of the Lord, which is faithful and true. We wear the breastplate of righteousness by guarding our heart, for out of it comes the issues of life. We wear on the shoes of the gospel of peace, running to take the gospel of Jesus Christ to those who are in darkness. We wear the shield of faith by living by faith and not by sight, confident of the evidence of the things unseen. We put on the helmet of salvation by fixing our minds on Jesus Christ. For the Lord is the light and our salvation. And we take on the sword of the Spirit. We take on that sword, knowing that we shall not live by any other provisional means that this world can give us, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, but by every word that is written in the Bible. And we take on and fight this battle. The position of a soldier in the army of God is this. It is on our knees. We fight our battles, advancing the kingdom of God, on our knees, by prayer and supplication for all saints. This is the armor David wore. This is the armor that we should be wearing as we are equipped for warfare. Let's lift to the Lord in prayer. Loving God and Heavenly Father, thank you, Father, because you are the captain of the armies of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I pray, Lord, that if there is anyone over here who is not part of your army, who wants to be part of that army, that they would say in their hearts, Lord Jesus, I give my life to you. I acknowledge that you are my Savior. I acknowledge I am a sinner. But I thank you, Lord, that my sinfulness can be removed and made clean, because I believe in my heart that you are the Son of God that was sent to man for the salvation of mankind. I believe in the cross on which you were nailed. I believe that you rose again on the third day and that you conquered sin and death once and for all. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that you will come into my heart, that you will guard my heart, and that you will help me to become a person, to be a person after your own heart. I pray, Lord, for the others who are here, that as we engage in battle, help us not to slip, O Master. Help us to fight to stay in the battle, so that when we meet you, when we get to see you face to face, you would be able to tell unto each one of us the highest praise that any one of us can ever receive from anyone in this universe. Well done, my good and faithful servant. I pray, Lord, that you will count us worthy to be able to record us as those who have given their lives for you. Help us, Lord, to not fall prey to sex, to silver, or to self, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, or the pride of life. But we pray, O Lord, that you will guard us and you will protect us, so that we are like onward Christian soldiers marching on to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. I pray, Lord Jesus, that you will be with us. Help us to be like David, who wore the armor as he faced the giant of his time, as we face the giants of our time, no matter what it is and what form it seems to, Lord, loom around us and above us. We thank you, Lord, that you will give us this shield of faith, the goggles of faith, with which we will see the supernatural, and through that we will be able to look at the victory that has already been won. Because, Lord, in the future, you reign, and that we will reign with you. We commit ourselves into your keeping once again, asking you, Lord Jesus, that you will increase and that we will decrease. In Jesus' name we pray.